Women's Policy Rollout Week. Are you
so
excited?
Excited? Very, yeah.
I'm super excited. My name is Jess O'Connell. I'm a senior advisor for Mayor Pete, and this is a really exciting week for our campaign. We're rolling out our national women's policy. So I invited Mayor Pete to come and sit down and tell us a little bit more about it. What are you most excited about in terms of the plan?
The fact that it is comprehensive, that it's not about any individual issue alone, but it's really about how they fit together. And it's about power. It's about making sure we enhance the social, economic, and political power of women.
I mean, I'm obviously Team Pete, right? I'm working with you in South Bend and with the team. And one of the things that I love about this team is that it is a majority women. I think a lot of people don't know that, actually. And I think it really speaks to how you're going to govern. I come out of a place like Emily's List. It's the largest organization for women in politics. I spent almost my whole career working to elect women, women of color. And so I get the question a lot. You know, why am I with Mayor Pete? And what's he going to do for women? I know you must feel like I do, which is I admire a lot of the women that are running for president.
Absolutely.
I helped elect a lot of them. But I know why I'm with you, but I'm curious about how you answer that for folks.
Yeah, I mean, I'm proud to be part of the most diverse field ever to compete for the presidency, including some extraordinary women leaders. I talk to a lot of voters who are disappointed that we haven't had a woman as president yet. So am I. Frankly,
me too.
A woman should be president right now.
Yeah.
And that's just a simple fact. At the same time, I think now each of us is competing based on what we propose to do. And my message to women who are wondering whether they should vote for someone like me is I'm hoping that you will support me. Whether you do or not, I'm definitely going to be supporting you. Because I know what it is to rely on alliances in order to secure some of my own rights. Things like my ability to marry is the most important thing in my life. It exists not only because of the leadership of people like me, but the support of people not at all like me. And it's one of the reasons why when we think about racial justice and when we think about gender equity in this country, I think it's important to have all of us supporting one another.
You had the chance to meet my son recently. Yeah. I see so many parallels, I think, in terms of you know, sort of intervention and opportunity around family and family planning and paid family leave. I mean, I think, you know, there's this sense that they're women's issues.
Right.
And it really frustrates me because these are issues for everybody.
To me, good family values are making sure it's possible to build a family and to thrive. We have an opportunity right now to actually deliver things like paid family leave, to deliver paid sick leave, and set it up in a way that it works. Whether you have a traditional full-time job with one employer, or as so many people are finding, your place in the economy is more complicated than that, with gig work, part-time work, folks with multiple jobs.
Watching people and families have to piece that together is really hard and seems long overdue.
And we need to make it easier. It shouldn't be this hard to be able to support a family, to be able to take care of a family, to be able to spend time with your family.
One of the things I love about this plan is it's about building power for women, which I think is pretty bold coming from a guy, but I love it.
As somebody who's worked as much as you have to make sure women are in seats of power, you know that so many of these policy issues only get better when we have empowered women in positions of responsibility and decision making. We know that our economy's growth is largely because women have been more and more in the workforce, and now we need to make sure women are in leadership in the workforce too. And yes, this certainly includes pay equality. It's why I'm insisting that companies be transparent and employers be transparent about gender pay gaps. And so many of the problems in our economy come down to the fact that people just plain aren't being paid enough. That is especially true for women and particularly true for women of color.
I think for a lot of women, this is a particularly scary time in the era that we're living in now with the current leadership that is not only in the White House, but actually kind of throughout the country, particularly related to choice. The entire time I've been alive, Roe v. Wade has been law of the land. But it's always been under assault.
Of course, it means appointing judges and justices who understand that this is part of American freedom. We've got to take executive action, protect Roe v. Wade legislatively, and make sure we have the right kind of judges and justices. Well, I think men need to learn how to be feminists. These are objectives that everyone in society should be behind. I think the Me Too movement was empowering for women, but really a wake-up call for men on things that have been tolerated or assumed away for far, far too long. This is a problem that doesn't get fixed unless we have a society-wide reckoning. It's happening at the social level. Now we've got to make sure that policy catches up.
Think we can do it?
We've got to. We've got to do it. And I really think we can. Part of what you'll get when you send a mayor like me to the White House is a mayor who has led a diverse city struggling with a lot of challenges of justice around race, around gender. These things really hit home, I think, on the ground. We already know that we've got a crisis of violence against transgender women of color. We've got to have an Equality Act that establishes that whether you are trans or otherwise in the LGBTQ community, it is not lawful for you to be discriminated against. I have a real sense of propulsion to get into the White House and make sure that it is a force for justice and belonging and inclusion. Mm-hmm. And that is especially true for our most vulnerable Americans, and that's often black trans women in this country.
I'm curious what women in your life have had the most impact on you.
You know, it starts with family, of course. And, you know, my mother is a strong, smart, professional woman. I've been privileged to work with so many extraordinary women. The first candidate I worked for was a woman running for Congress. Some of the most inspiring and impressive leaders around the country. I'm thinking of folks like Nan Whaley, the mayor of Dayton, Ohio, who responded magnificently to the tragedy, the shooting they had there, but just has been an all-around great leader. I'm thinking about people like Jacinda Ardern, the prime minister in New Zealand, who also in the wake of tragedy demonstrated the kind of strength and compassion and leadership that I hope a new wave of world leaders will be able to advance on the world stage.
Has there been a particular story or someone that you've met along the trail that was surprising or something that sort of stayed with you?
In community after community, I'm meeting women who are really changing the story of their neighborhoods, their towns, their cities. And it's a privilege to encounter them and to continue to think about how to make sure that my campaign and eventually my presidency can be supporting them. You're making history. You are changing what the future of this country is going to look like, and that we can't do it without you. You know, the first time I really felt hopeful, I think, after the election, certainly after the inauguration, was seeing the Women's March. And the one in South Bend was really moving, not only because of the message it sent, but because it had this generational quality. Now, there were young women, and there were their mothers and their grandmothers at their side cheering them on. And it had a kind of joyful quality, even as it was responding to this horrible challenge that we're faced with. That's the spirit that we need across the country if we're going to turn the page, not only defeat this president, but replace this presidency with something better. The women of this country are going to be at the absolute forefront of making it happen.
Great. Well, I'm going to hold you to that. I'm proud to be with you. Thanks,
Thank
Mayor.
You.
Jess O'Connell, I am a senior advisor to Pete Buttigieg. I thought I would start with a quick campaign update. Thanks to so many of you, no one has come so far so fast in this race. It is remarkable what we have been able to do in such a short amount of time. In January, we started with 6 people, and we are now over 400 people on this campaign working hard throughout the country. We started with $0. We have $51 million that we are using to communicate our message out there. We have over 500,000 grassroots donors and donors that are helping fuel this campaign to ensure that we have an opportunity to get our message out to everyone. And so thank you all for your help in that. In New Hampshire here, we're over 60 staff members, and we've got 13 offices in all 10 counties throughout the state. We are really excited about the work we are doing right here in New Hampshire. And I'll let you in on a little secret. This campaign is powered by women. A majority of women, 53% to be exact, who I might add earn equal pay for equal work. In fact, it's no surprise that women are leading the way across the country. We are a majority of volunteers. We're a majority of voters. And it's women who decide elections. That matters, because this is the most important election in my lifetime. That's why I'm so proud to work for Mayor Pete. He understands what women have been up against, and not just over the last 2 years. That's why Pete is putting forward the most ambitious, comprehensive proposal of any candidate to invest in women's economic and social empowerment, to tackle gender and race-based health disparities, and to break systemic barriers designed to hold women back. As the former executive director of Emily's List, the largest organization for women in the country, I am paying close attention to issues of representation and protecting reproductive rights and economic issues that impact not just women, but all families. That's why I'm especially excited about Pete's pledges in his new plan. And his plan has a pretty awesome name. Here's what it is: Building Power. Building Power, a women's agenda for the 21st century. And it is about women's power. President Buttigieg will appoint at least 50% of women to the cabinet and the judiciary. That has never been done before. President Buttigieg will protect and codify the right to abortion into law. That has never been done. And President Buttigieg will finally achieve paid leave for families, also never been done. But to get these things done, we need a mayor to deliver to Washington something that looks more like our best-run cities in town, not the other way around. That's why we need Pete, a leader with bold ideas who can bring us together to get things done and to think about the future. When I decided to join Mayor Pete in this race, I was thinking about the future. Mayor Pete talks about the year 2054. That is when he will be the age that President Trump is right now. Well, I have a new little baby boy, and in 2054, he'll be Pete's age that he is right now. And when I realized that and I thought about the issues that we face, not just today and not just in this election, I realized that we need a leader in this time who can take us beyond and into the future with bold ideas and a way to bring us all together. Because you see, most Americans agree on so many different issues, and it's really about how we can come together in those. And it's not about one election or one day or one candidate. It's about the future. And Mayor Pete can deliver that if we can get it done for him. Pete says that running for office is an act of hope. Well, I say his running for president gives me an awful lot of hope. Yeah. And I hope that you feel the same, because I think together we can change the channel and we can talk about the issues that most Americans agree we need to solve together. Mayor Pete can get that done. So thank you very much. I'm excited to bring him out. But first, I want to introduce you to a couple of remarkable women, because we are here to talk about the power of women. Jennifer Frizzell, she's the director of policy for the New Hampshire Women's Foundation. She previously, yes, absolutely. She previously spent 15 years leading public policy and political work for Planned Parenthood of Northern New England. And she also served two terms as New Hampshire State Senate Policy Director. And over the past two decades, she's coordinated litigation and legislative advocacy to secure and protect access to safe, legal abortion and to defeat attacks against Planned Parenthood and its services, including state and federal lawsuits. There's nothing I love more than introducing an incredible woman, Jennifer Frizzell. Thank you, everybody.
Hello to my friends from Bow and Concord and beyond. Thank you, Jess, and thanks to Mayor Pete Buttigieg for using your campaign to put a spotlight on those issues which are critical to advancing women's social, economic, and political power. As you heard, I've spent my career as an attorney, an advocate, and an activist here in New Hampshire working to obtain justice and equality for women across many issues, representing domestic violence victims to help them achieve physical and economic security as a legal aid lawyer, fighting for women's access to reproductive health care, including safe legal abortion, for more than a decade with Planned Parenthood, and promoting women's empowerment and leadership in my current role with a nonprofit foundation focused on gender equality and opportunity for women and girls. Drawing upon all these experiences, I welcome Pete's comprehensive policy to build enduring power for women. I want to emphasize the phrase building power, and thank you, Pete, for putting that in the title of your policy and bluntly acknowledging it. Too often there is a stigma or a criticism around the idea of women seeking or articulating the desire for power. But in reality, power is equality. It's not just a seat at the table, but controlling who gets invited to the table. By recognizing that we can only break down systems of gender discrimination and equality with more women in power, this policy works to address the entirety of women's lived experience in our society today. Issues of economic security, our physical and mental health, our ability to live free of violence and to make decisions about whether and when to have children, they are all interrelated. And this policy, released by Pete today, aims to address the interconnectedness and the many systems that are preventing women from economic and social advancement. No one policy can deliver the progress that women need to find an equal place at life's table. We need an intersectional approach that includes improving access to healthcare, reforming workplace policies, creating more opportunities to lead, and yes, ensuring reproductive rights and freedoms. I'm so pleased that Pete chose to release this policy proposal here in New Hampshire, where we've been fighting hard for fairer economic policies like paid family and medical leave, and where we see the protections of Roe v. Wade are hanging by a thread with the U.S. Supreme Court stacked with the majority of anti-choice justices. While we'll continue to work here locally to level the playing field for women, federal requirements and resources and leadership from the presidency will be necessary to significantly move the gender debate forward. At our current rate, it will take 202 years to close the gender pay gap and 100 years to reach parity and equal representation in our state legislature. That's far too long to wait. Pete's plan would help dramatically shrink those timelines so we can achieve this equality in our lifetime. We need a president in the White House who will not only protect the progress that we've made, but who will put their foot on the gas pedal to accelerate that progress at a much greater speed. And with that goal in mind, I'm excited to have the opportunity to hear more from Pete directly on these issues tonight and to turn things over to our next speaker, who is our neighbor from the South, Representative Maria Robinson from Framingham, Massachusetts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. And just so you know, I do drive a Subaru, so hopefully you'll accept me for tonight. So my name is Representative Maria Robinson, and in 2019, I became the first Korean American ever to be elected to the Massachusetts legislature. Thank you. Thanks. And before serving in the House, I spent a decade in public policy as an expert in clean energy, working on the state and federal levels. And Mayor Pete, he first came onto my radar back in early 2017 during the DNC race for chair. Might be true for many of you. In fact, my very first interaction with the Massachusetts Democratic Party was sending an email asking them to support Pete for chair. I knew right then that he was someone worth following. And he wasn't just a politician, he was a person. So now fast forward to 2018, I was debating back and forth whether I should run for state representative. When I reflected on the situation, I remembered how I saw Pete really confidently running for a role that he knew that he had the skill set for, and that he was right for, despite what other people might have been saying to him. At the same time, I had people calling for me to run for something smaller. Many women might have some similar experience there, telling me I should run for school committee first. But I knew that my skill set was right for the state level. Now, there are a lot of really wonderful people running for president. I even worked for one of the people, former candidate, Governor Jay Inslee, back when he was in Congress. But I knew from the very beginning that Pete was my candidate. We talk a lot about how representation matters. We're here tonight to talk about women in particular. And as an Asian American woman, you might expect me to see myself and someone different in this race. But I see myself most closely with the millennial generation. and I see myself mostly with the millennial in this race. We're a generation that's facing problems that no other era before us has ever had to face, and in particular, women have ever had to face. And we need someone who can feel that generational pain to lead us. We need someone who can look beyond the politics of tomorrow to find the solutions well into the future. That person's Pete. And so today, we're here to talk about, oh, yes, clap for him. Absolutely. So today we're here to talk about how Pete has put forward the most comprehensive and ambitious proposal from any presidential candidate to build and secure women's power. Like he does in every proposal, he's tackling the root problems, not the symptoms, and he's tackling inequities in our country through structural reform. Us nerdy people like to do things like that. Out of the many policies contained in this proposal, I'm especially thrilled that a President Buttigieg would make sure that women would get equal pay for equal work by requiring gender pay transparency and holding employers accountable for discrimination. Now that I'm a public elected official, I know for the very first time in my life that I'm actually earning equal pay to my peers. Everyone deserves that surety, and Pete's gonna make sure that that happens. Next, he's, as previously mentioned, he's going to protect women's health care and rights. He's going to enshrine reproductive rights into law to ensure that all women will have control over their bodies. Yeah. Women are not going to have to worry about that right being taken away by changes in the court, because it'll be written into statute. Having a lasting legacy long beyond his administration. I love this one. In addition, Pete's plan empowers young women to break through the ridiculous false choice that we're so often given, that you have to choose between having a career or having a family. This is one that I, as a 32-year-old mom, really acutely feel. And Pete would ensure that all working Americans, regardless of gender, will have access to 12 weeks of paid family leave and ensure that workers have access to earned sick leave. So no matter where you work, no matter where you work, you'll have access, believe it or not, to high quality, full day childcare, free for families most in need and affordable for everyone. It's huge. So for the past few years, I've been a foster parent. We just recently adopted our daughter. Thank you. And I have to tell you, what I've seen in the foster care system would break your heart. The system, our system, isn't set up to support women and their families. And especially those women and their families, these children that are in the toughest economic conditions. And I know that Pete's plan will tackle systemic issues head on and give women the opportunity and the support that they deserve. So, look, the challenges our country faces today feel insurmountable. I know right now, October 2019, they feel very insurmountable, but the future does not have to be a dark place. It doesn't. Our country has overcome tremendous challenges before, and we can do it again as long as we have the right leader in place. And Pete is exactly the leader that we need to meet our challenges and to win the era. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Pete Buttigieg.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, New Hampshire. My name is Pete Buttigieg. Feel free to call me Mayor Pete. I am a candidate for president. A Midwestern millennial. An Episcopalian veteran. And I am a feminist. And I'm really excited to be here in Bow. We've had a great day, and you can feel fall, and with it a different kind of energy in this race. I know when we feel winter, it'll be a little different, but I like this feeling. There's something about it, just the crisp air and that cool breeze on the back of your neck that just feels perfect for door knocking. Speaking of which, please be sure to reach out to our wonderful organizers, including Jennifer Jackson, if you're interested in participating in the campaign. I want to thank Representative Maria Robinson for your support, for sharing your story and your inspiration with us. I want to thank Jess O'Connell for her leadership. She has dedicated her career to lifting up women and has helped build and steer this campaign as we have grown from 4 people, which is what we were in January, to roughly 100 times that. And I really enjoyed the opportunity to visit with Jess's wife, Holly, and their 16-month-old Aiden, who are holding down the fort in Maryland while Jess is in South Bend with us. And I'm so deeply grateful to everyone on this campaign who has picked up their lives and sacrificed so much because they believe that we can do something special. And a big thank you also to Jennifer Frizzell for your continued leadership and commitment to empowering women across this state and beyond. Please join me one more time in thanking each of our speakers on the program. So in the event that any of you decide to run for president, you will learn that one of the best things about it, probably the best, is that you encounter people all over the country in person, in letters, in emails that they send, and you learn about what is at stake. They reach out to you about whatever matters most to them. And in particular, we've been hearing from young people, many of them not even old enough to vote, to let us know what these campaigns mean to them. I got a note from someone named Leah, who lives just about an hour or so south of here. She's 12, but she told me she's going to be 13 soon. And what she wrote about was the pay gap and equal rights. She said, in some places, people act as though men are at a much higher level than women, which is not right. And I want her to know I couldn't agree more. It is not right. She signed off by saying, I'm a big fan and hope that you can try to do something about women's rights when you hopefully become president. So what I want her to know is that when I am president, we're not just going to try to do something about this issue. We are going to deliver action on women's rights in this country. And I appreciate this opportunity to lay out exactly what I'm planning to do starting on January 20th of 2021. It's a good day to think about it. And yet, I'm not sure we're thinking about it enough. I think there's been so much focus on beating this president, appropriately so, because he amounts to a national emergency, and he's got to go. But we've also got to think about what comes next. This is part of what I was trying to convey at the last debate, that we've got to bear in mind the image of what's going to happen the day after Donald Trump. Because one way or the other, this presidency is coming to an end. So that thought, when you're really picturing that day, might first bring a smile or at least a sigh of relief. We can turn the page on this particular kind of corruption and chaos and, needless to say, the tweets. But on that day, the sun is going to come up over a country even more torn up over politics and even more polarized than we've been. If you just think about everything we've been through and everything we're about to go through, it's going to leave us in a very tender place. And the challenges, the crises, really, that have brought us to this point, They haven't been taking a vacation during this presidency or the impeachment process. So the sun's going to come up over a country rapidly approaching the point of no return when it comes to climate change. It's going to rise over a nation still beset by a gun violence epidemic that is stealing lives at our schools and houses of worship and on the streets of cities like mine. The sun's going to come up over an economy where so many Americans feel like they can't get ahead or can barely even hold on to what they've got, and where millions lack health care or can't afford treatment even if they have coverage. And yes, another problem is that the sun is going to rise over a country where women make up half the population, but hold only a fraction of the political and social and economic power. It's a country where women make up nearly half of workers in corporate America, but where right now, among Fortune 500 CEOs, there are almost as many named James as there are women altogether. This is a country where we, on one hand, a country where we can celebrate a superstar athlete like Megan Rapinoe, but she deserves a hand. We're also a country where even Megan Rapinoe does not yet get paid the same as a man doing the same job. This is a country where a woman can run for president and get the votes of the majority of American voters. But also that same country is somehow one that allowed into the Oval Office a man who abuses and denigrates women on a regular basis. By the way, call me simple-minded, but this is one of many reasons why I think we might just want to pick our president by counting up all the votes and giving it to the person who got the most in November. So I'm running to be the president for that day after, the president who will pick up the pieces and help put this nation back together, president who can bring people together to bring about the bold changes and fixes we're going to need to handle these urgent crises that we face. And a huge part of that entails ensuring that women's power in our economy, our political system, and every part of our society is strong. And as a male candidate, I think it's even more important for me to speak up about these issues, because whether or not you are for me, I want every woman voting to know that I am here for you. So, today we've released a comprehensive plan to build out that power, not just dealing with one issue at a time, but looking at how they fit together. It's a plan that recognizes the ways that women who are marginalized because of their other identities, because they are women of color or LGBTQ, are often doubly impacted, and thus puts them at the center of what we need to do. And if you want to read the full 26-page plan, which covers everything from banning the use of salary histories to expanding rural maternal health care to protecting a woman's right to choose, I would invite you to go to peepforamerica.com because I know you can read faster than I can talk. But this evening, I want to take the chance to share a few words about the four main pillars of this policy. So, first and foremost, it is time to close the pay and wealth gaps in America. I've been thinking a lot today about some of the most influential women in my life. One was the woman who taught me high school economics. Her name was Julia Chismar, and everybody should have someone believe in them the way she believed in me. She's been a big part of this campaign, too. But it doesn't take economic training to appreciate that there is a problem when women are half our workforce, but only paid 82 cents on the dollar. And just 62 cents if you are a black woman, 54 if you are Latina. At the current rate, we will not fully close the gender pay gap in over 200 years, and that is unacceptable. So, what are we going to do about it? Well, first, require large public employers to make any gender pay gap that they have public, in addition to reporting if people of color are getting paid the same as their white coworkers, and whether women and minority workers are stuck in low-paying jobs. Something tells me when that information is out in the open, we're going to see behavior change quite a bit among these employers. That's only part of the story. We've got to look at the ways that women are excluded from opportunity to begin with. We know that becoming a parent, for example, gives a father a boost at work, but permanently costs a mother income. So we're going to ensure that every family has access to affordable childcare and every worker has 12 weeks of paid family leave, whether you have a traditional job or whether you're doing gig work or part-time work or working multiple jobs, because in the 21st century, you should not have to choose between a career and a family. We know that harassment and discrimination still cost women promotion and opportunities at work and drives so many women from the workplace altogether, which is why we are going to invest $10 billion to end workplace sexual harassment and other discrimination against women and double funding for the EEOC to hold employers accountable when they discriminate. We know that women start businesses at similar rates as men and actually have been shown to generate better returns for their investors. Yet they receive less than 3% of venture capital funding. So we're going to increase small business loans and grants, crack down on lending discrimination, and make available loans that can unlock over $50 billion in capital to grow the women-owned businesses that will benefit the entire American economy when they are given a chance to thrive. That's what it looks like to do something about economic empowerment. Now, under the second pillar of our plan, my administration will advance women's health and, yes, protect a woman's right to choose. You know, one focus of our campaign is values, values like freedom, and having a richer understanding of what freedom means. And that means appreciating what our friends on the other side of the aisle can't always seem to acknowledge, which is that real freedom means not just freedom from government, but the freedom to live a life of your choosing. This is the deepest sense of American freedom. But sometimes, I agree, sometimes freedom does mean getting government out of the way. And that's why we need to get government out of the business of dictating to women what their reproductive health care choices ought to be. I say that as a pro-choice Democrat governing in South Bend, Indiana, where not everybody I know, not even everybody who supports me, views the issue in exactly the same way. But I think that even if we can't all agree on where to draw the line, I think we ought to be able to agree on who gets to draw the line, and I trust women to make those decisions. So when I'm president, I will appoint judges and justices who share this understanding of American freedom. We will get rid of the Hyde Amendment, which disproportionately impacts low-income women and women of color, and we will encode abortion rights into national law. Not only does this mean insisting that every insurance plan in America cover abortion services, but my administration will guarantee every woman and every American affordable health coverage through Medicare for all who want it. This, I believe, is what it means to recognize that health care is freedom too, that we create a public alternative, but give you the choice to decide whether and when to switch to our plan or keep your private plan. I just trust you to make that decision for yourself. And as vital as reproductive freedom and reproductive health are, we know that there are a lot of other health issues that matter to women. That's why we got to tackle disparities in health from expanding research into diseases that disproportionately impact women, to ensuring that LGBTQ people receive respectful care, to eliminating racial disparities in maternal mortality. This is equity, and this is our values. And it's why we've got to end the stigma and the silence around issues like mental health and addiction. means putting real resources into dealing with the crisis of healing and belonging in this country, and recognizing that if women are twice as likely as men to experience serious mental illness, then mental health parity is a women's health issue and a justice issue too. Now, the third pillar is safe and inclusive communities, something that can't be separated from women's empowerment and health. Earlier today, I had the opportunity to meet with a number of survivors at the New Hampshire Coalition Against Domestic and Sexual Violence. It was a powerful reminder that domestic violence is not limited to any particular region or race or class. It impacts so many women and so many families, and it is time for that to change. In the United States of America, no woman should feel unsafe in her own home. No woman should question her safety as she walks across a darkened lot or steer clear of a certain part of the office. No woman should be subjected to hateful tweets or messages or cyberbullying online. And that is why, in addition to reauthorizing the Violence Against Women Act, my administration will take a 21st century approach to gender-based violence as it moves into the digital sphere. We're going to close the boyfriend loophole, because when a woman is murdered by a male intimate partner with a gun every 16 hours, it is long past time we saw to it that no one convicted of domestic abuse can get their hands on a gun. We're going to pass the Equality Act and strengthen protections against discrimination based on gender and sexual identity. And we're going to stand up to the epidemic of violence against transgender Americans. 21 trans people is 21 too many lost this year. And instead of a Department of Education that chips away at Title IX protections on campus, we're going to strengthen those protections. And I will appoint a Secretary of Education who actually believes in public education for every American. This is also about culture. Men need to learn how to be feminists. The Me Too movement, galvanized largely by black women like Tarana Burke, has been empowering for women. It's also been a wake-up call for a lot of men. It has brought to light things that have been tolerated or assumed away for far too long. And this problem won't get fixed without a society-wide reckoning. So we have to change the culture of harassment and discrimination by teaching consent in school and tackling online harassment. And I will do everything that I can to use the moral leadership of the White House to model a sense of inclusion and belonging for all until we have the right culture in this nation. Finally, we are going to close the leadership gap so that women can secure equal power and influence in the United States. I know I don't need to tell New Hampshire anything about the power of women's leadership. It is impressive. Matter of fact, you all had a woman governor, Senate president, and House speaker back around when I was still in high school. You got a lot to be proud of here. And this state continues to lead the way on electing women who know how to bring people together and get things done. As Congresswoman Custer has put it, if you can raise toddlers and deal with teenagers, you can deal with Republicans and Democrats in the United States Congress. That sounds like the right approach. I'm looking forward to joining Congresswoman Custer tomorrow in New London. I know just how much it can mean to see yourself represented by somebody like you. because I'm continually moved by people, especially young people who tell me what it means when they see themselves in me or when they see someone like my husband out on the campaign trail. And I know that whether it's our government or a private company, the decisions that we make are better when they are informed by a wide range of voices and views. Matter of fact, there's a whole literature showing that companies with more women on their boards and senior teams perform better. They're more profitable because they make better decisions. The same is true of countries. It's one reason I'm glad my campaign team is majority women, 40% people of color, and more than a quarter LGBTQ. It speaks to the inclusion that is going to be necessary, not just to win, but in order to govern this country well. So this is why I am pleased to pledge that when I am president, my cabinet will be at least 50% women, and so will my nominations to the judiciary. That's a commitment you're going to see reflected across our government, and we're going to challenge state and local governments to do the same, because personnel is policy, and maybe we'd get better policies if we had more balance and equity at the table. We're going to reinstate the White House Council on Women and Girls to ensure that gender equity is at the forefront of our policies at home and abroad. And anyone who runs for political office knows that it is challenging to raise money. It is particularly difficult, it has been shown to be so, for women running for office to raise money. So to invest in women's political power, we're going to reform our campaign system. And when we implement a small dollar matching program for federal elections, it is going to make it easier for anyone historically excluded to get that seat at the table, run for office, win, and represent other Americans well. And if anyone feels like making those small dollar donations in cash, when I'm president, you'll be able to do it with a woman on those bills, because we're going to get the process back on track to put Harriet Tubman on the $20 bill. I also believe there is a responsibility to make sure that women are empowered to rise to the top, not just in government, but in the private sector. So we will establish incentives and requirements to increase the number of women on corporate boards and in C-suites. Our economy has grown largely because women have been increasingly present in the workforce, and it's time to make sure that women are in leadership in the workforce as well. Lastly, we are not just going to win the era, as we proudly set out to do in this campaign. We're also going to win the ERA, because it is time for the Equal Rights Amendment to get passed. You know, alongside the extraordinary women who led and championed that fight was an Indiana senator named Birch Bayh. And this was a time when we understood that we should look to the Constitution for reform. I believe that with another Hoosier in charge, we have a chance once again to get this done. I know this is a tough moment for our country, and sometimes it is our darkest moments that bring out what is best in us, what is good in us. You might even say what is great in us. And so often, in those tough moments, it has been women who have shown great moral leadership. Ida B. Wells rising from slavery to help found the NAACP. Dorothy Day gathering a movement of Catholic workers to fight poverty in the name of their faith. The women organizing movements for justice in our time, from insisting that Black Lives Matter to demanding accountability for those abusing their power, to those marching for their lives, to the wave of women who helped us retake Congress in 2018. And the first time I felt really hopeful after the election in 2016, certainly first time I felt real hope after the inauguration, was the Women's March. Seeing the hundreds of thousands of people on the Mall in Washington was inspiring, but we had one in South Bend too. I went down there, it was by our Performing Arts Center, and folks marched through downtown South Bend. It ended with a dance party. On that tough day for America, there was such joy as well as a sense of determination to fix what was wrong. I remember all the signs that were around there. Love trumps hate. Women's rights are human rights. Quoting Audre Lorde, I am deliberate and afraid of nothing. Seeing those signs gave me hope. And what gave me the most hope was seeing people brought together. It had this generational feel. There were young women, not marching as you have seen in some other moments of history against their parents, but this time, young women with their mothers and their grandmothers at their side cheering them on. It was inspiring. And there were men too. And the march was sponsored by everyone from the League of Women Voters to our local YWCA to racial justice groups and our LGBTQ center and folks from the University of Notre Dame and Indiana University. And it was a reminder for me that so much about progress in our time is about enlisting allies. It was a reminder that my own rights exist not only because of the efforts of people like me, but the support of people not like me. And even as we were responding to that horrible challenge, and in January 27, I think even then we didn't know just how bad it would get. But there was a kind of belonging and joy in coming together to stand for our values. That is the kind of spirit we need in this country if we're going to turn the page. It's a spirit I am seeing everywhere on the trail. Women who are changing the story of their neighborhoods, their towns, their communities. And it's what we're going to need, not just to defeat this president, but to replace this presidency with something better. And if we can do that, then a decade from now, I can write back to somebody like Leah, who by then will be old enough to vote, but if all goes well, I won't be asking her for her vote. But maybe she'll be running for office. Maybe she'll be inspired to be a leader. And I'll be able to say to her, I'm sorry about how bad it got by the time you wrote me in 2019. But look at what we did in 2020 to make sure that we brought equity in our time. That's the kind of hope that makes me tick, to be able to say, I'm sorry it got that bad, but look at what we did so that every woman and girl in America will know what real equality feels like. Look at what we did to pave the way for women of every background to exercise full and equal economic, social, and political power. The women of this country are going to be at the forefront of making that happen. And I will be with them. I will be with you every step of the way. Thank you. So now, we never want these events to just be a monologue. So please welcome back to the stage to moderate and lead a discussion, and then we'll go to Q&A. Please welcome back Jess O'Connell, Jennifer Frizzell, and Representative Maria Robinson.
Job, which is I get to ask my boss questions in front of lots of people. That's unusual. So I'm obviously super excited about this plan, and I know that you and the team have been working really hard on it, and I love the chance that we can dig in a little bit. And one of the things that I've been thinking about, you mentioned I'm a new mom and a parent, and so thinking about issues in a slightly different way, and the issue of equal pay, it's not just, you know, the pay gap isn't just about equal pay. There are a lot of factors that factor into that, things like childcare responsibilities, some of the lower income paying jobs, things like harassment that might take women out of the workplace, all those kinds of things. How does your plan impact that? How can we make changes? Not just obviously on equal pay. We know you know how to do that because the campaign's certainly doing a good job. I think women might be making even a little bit more than the men on this campaign. So you've got that one covered. I feel good about that. But some of these other issues.
Yeah, it's one of the reasons why it's so important that the plan be comprehensive. And so you will see in there is certainly equal pay for equal work. In other words, two people with the same title, job title, doing the same work, the same quality. When that is not being compensated equally, it's wrong, it's against the law, and we need to step up the ability to enforce against that kind of discrimination. But as you say, that's only part of the story. A lot of this is in the structure of the workforce. So when, for example, women are forced to leave work because they can't get access to affordable childcare, there is a lot of evidence that when they eventually do return to the workforce, it's just they've missed chances at advancement. They've missed raises, and that gap follows them through the end of their working life. It's one of the reasons why we need to make sure that childcare is affordable for all parents in this country, and that you don't have to be forced to make that choice. There's also a lot of evidence that as a consequence of harassment and discrimination, you have a lot of women leaving the workforce altogether or will be compelled to leave a job and accept another job at a lower level of pay just to get out of a work environment that is hostile to them or that isn't safe. So it's why we need to put so many resources into preventing workplace harassment and, again, create the enforcement structure so that that doesn't happen, whether it's in person at a workplace or whether it's the sorts of things that are unfortunately increasingly moving online. And we need to act on that. When we diminish the ways in which people are sidelined from the workforce, we can make sure that careers are more successful, that they have more continuity, that people are in a more powerful negotiating. When women are able to negotiate for the next job, whether it's the promotion or a transition, we know that that empowerment is going to boost their economic earning power. And these steps, I think, will be just as important as enforcing on naked pay discrimination in order to make sure that we close that gap.
Thank you very much. Jennifer?
Yes. Thanks, Mayor Pete. I wanted to ask a little bit more deeply about your commitment to protecting abortion rights. With the Roe v. Wade decision hanging in the balance and so many Republican-led state legislatures in the South and in the Midwest placing abortion under sustained attack, the policy conversation often turns to protecting the legal right to abortion, reinforcing the constitutional right to abortion, but what we've so often seen is that the right to abortion is hollow for women unless there's real access. And in more than 80% of the counties of this country, there's no safe legal abortion provider for women. And so I'd like to hear a little bit more about how your plan not only will ensure that women have legal rights, but also will make sure abortion is accessible, especially for the most vulnerable, low-income women in rural areas and women of color.
It's a really important point, especially because this disproportionately impacts those who are most in need, women of color and low-income women. And as you say, there's work to do just protecting the legal right to abortion. It's why my judges and justices that I appoint will be ones who respect that, and why we need to make sure that we encode in law the principles of Roe versus Wade. But it doesn't mean much if you can't actually get access. This is why we need to repeal the Hyde Amendment, because the lack of funding, it makes all the difference for low-income women. It's also why we need to do away with the Title X gag rule, because we know that when there's a medically unnecessary or even medically inaccurate block on information, when providers cannot give referrals, we know that that makes it that much harder for anybody to be part of a network where the cost can be addressed. We know that there will be a shortage of providers continuing. Our community has at times been one of those areas where you can't get service. And if you can't also, if you don't have reliable transportation in order to travel to an abortion provider, then you might as well not have that right in practice. It's why we need to make sure that the education is there to have qualified providers. And it's why we need to make sure that unnecessary restrictions that are often also creatively deployed, I would say, at a local level, are subject to enforcement of that
equal right. And it's why it's so important that everybody have coverage. It's why, whether it's through Medicare for All Who Want It or a private plan, everyone have coverage, and we insist that that coverage include abortion services. That's how we make sure that the right is real and not just on paper.
Well, I was part of a much larger national wave of women coming into office in 2018, which was terrific, and I think, but there's still a ton of progress to be made in order to lower the barriers to entry for women into office. For reference, in the Massachusetts legislature, there are more men named Dan than there are women of color. Just to give you a sense, even in a very progressive-ish state like Massachusetts. So would love to hear a little more about what we can do to encourage women to get into civic participation, and in particular to get them into office.
Great. So first of all, this is why campaign finance reform is so important, or it's one of many reasons why it's so important, right? It's important for our democracy, but it's important for equity because it can be a real barrier, especially if you think about how different inequities overlap, right? So we talked about the women's wealth gap. Fewer women are personally wealthy, and that means fewer women can bankroll their own campaign, which is one more obstacle. Childcare, same thing. You know, often there's this, I think folks imagine people running for president. The majority of people who run for office are running for offices that are part-time and are either undercompensated or minimally compensated. And so childcare could be all the difference from whether you are or not able to run for school board or city council or state legislature or some of the offices that then turn into a pipeline for people to run for other offices. So childcare gets at this. There's this finding that on average, women need to be asked, I think it was 7 times, in order to run for office. For whatever reason, men don't have the same hesitation about putting their names forward. It's why on the political side, we need to invest in organizations. And there are fantastic ones that recruit and empower women, because I can certainly tell you from the community of mayors that some of the most extraordinary mayors of our time are women doing a wonderful job. And it's the same with you and your colleagues in the world of state legislatures and on and on. So we know that that's going to be very important. And part of it is culture. Part of it is what we are teaching in our schools. When we are able to build that national museum of women's history, when we are able to develop the kind of curriculum in all of our schools that sees to it that both young women and girls and young men and boys understand women's leadership as being the most natural thing in the world in politics, a lot of other things start to get better. And so I think we need to take all of these actions in concert. And, of course, we need to lift up the stories and examples of women like you who represent so well this new generation of leadership that, in our time, I really believe will reach equity or majority for women in elected office.
I think we can take a question from the audience.
All right. Put your hand up and a mic will come to you. Right there, you're close to the mic. Yeah.
Hi, I guess I'll stand up. Hi, my name is Beth Sloot. I live in the town of Bow, and I actually have two different questions. One's foreign policy and one is actually healthcare related.
Okay.
And my foreign policy question for you is, how do you plan to stand up to China with in regards to Tibet and the human rights atrocities that are going on there? And my second question is, you've talked about Medicare for all who want it. What is your plan to pay for that? And how do you plan to fix it on either end, where you can't afford it because it's $500 a month because you don't qualify for subsidies to make it affordable? And then when you do be able to afford it, you can't afford it on the other end because your deductibles are so sky high.
Right. So let me take the second one first. So what we're going to do is we're going to keep the structure that allows there to be subsidies for people for whom cost is a barrier. But also, as you go up in income to where you're no longer in the zone where the majority of the subsidies kick in, we're going to establish a cap of how much of your income it can be. And we're going to set that so it can never rise above 8.5% of your income, so that it's always affordable. And we're going to associate that with caps on out-of-pocket costs, too, because we know that whether you got coverage, regardless of coverage, so many Americans are facing problems with the affordability of prescription drug costs and the copays themselves. How it's paid for? Really important question. So for us, the total cost over 10 years is about $1.5 trillion. So just in case anybody tells you that what we're proposing is not a big deal, it's certainly a major, major investment. But we can raise that money through two sources. One of them is rolling back the corporate tax rate cut from the Trump tax cuts, because we don't need them. That's the vast majority of it. The other $100 billion or so we can gain through the savings to the Treasury that would come through actually allowing Medicare and Health and Human Services to negotiate drug costs with drug providers. On China, just to give the abbreviated answer, you're right. This is one area where I view it maybe a little different than some in my party. I think the China challenge is a big deal. I don't embrace the president's approach of just poking him in the eye to see what happens, because what happens is they poke back and it's coming down on the backs of farmers and consumers, and this trade war is getting us nowhere. But we should stand up for those who seek democracy and freedom of religion and expression wherever they are. And whether it's Tibet or Xinjiang province where the Muslim Uyghurs are being interned, or Hong Kong where people are standing up for democracy, people ought to know that they have a friend in the United States. They should at least hear moral support from the United States of America for their aspirations. And if we're doing that, we are leading in the best tradition of America's values on the world stage. And now is a moment, with American credibility dangling by a thread, when we would do really well to remind everybody of what American leadership at its best can look like, and that includes standing up for democracy. All right. Come over to the left side. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Anna Goebel. I'm a senior in high school. My question is, how does your faith impact the way you create policy specifically around women's issues?
Great question. So let me start by saying this. When you are running for office, when you are in office, and definitely when you're making policy, you are responsible for serving people of every religion and of no religion equally. It's a fundamental principle in life. That being said, I certainly want to be transparent about how I'm formed. And my faith affects the way I view the world. Not in a way that I would ever impose on anybody else, but in a way that helps me think about what's important. And I think a lot about the teachings of my faith tradition on our responsibility to identify with the marginalized, the responsibility to care for the poor and to feed the hungry, and to take care of the sick. And there's scripture that says that when you encounter somebody who is imprisoned, you should think of yourself as if you were in prison with them. And the idea of welcoming the stranger, stranger, of course, meaning immigrant. It's a synonym. And seeing equal dignity and equal worth in every human being. And, of course, that has implications for gender equity, just that idea of equal, of equality. And in the same way that that my faith tradition teaches that everyone deserves equal concern and love in the eyes of God, it's certainly the case that everyone deserves equal concern and support and respect in the eyes of the law. And while I would never impose my religious beliefs on anybody else, they certainly help propel me in this direction that I think everybody should be able to agree on, no matter what faith tradition you come from, if any, because these are also moral ideas that I think are the bedrock of our country and our community. And I think it's really important for those voters who are guided by faith to know that they have a choice. And that choice by no means requires you to endorse or condone the sort of thing that's going on in this White House, because that is out of keeping with any moral tradition I've ever seen. Pass over this way. All right. We got one right here.
My name's Kristen. I live in Manchester, and I'm here to talk about Alzheimer's tonight. So, as you know, I'm sure, nearly 6 million Americans have Alzheimer's disease. 200,000 of them started under the age of 65. Some are even under 40 years old. And so my husband was 53 when he started. Our daughter was only 10. Right, the gasp. It's always a good one. So my question to you is, you know, my daughter's in college now, and so I am likely to be in the Medicaid look-back period. He's had this disease for 7.5 years. So it's likely I'm going to be looking at the Medicaid process within the next five to six years. So that 5-year look-back period tells me that my 18-year-old needs to be financially independent, and that I am not able to help her with college costs or healthcare costs or anything as part of that look-back period. What will happen is everything that I spend on her going forward within that 5 years will be calculated into a formula and compared against the cost of care. And I'll be penalized, well, my husband will be penalized, but as the caregiver, you know, I'll be penalized as well. I'll be missing work, I won't be contributing to my retirement, I will be caring for him in a situation where I am not trained to care for him. And so, looking at that, my daughter is also being penalized right now, whereas she thinks she needs to be financially independent, and she doesn't even want to ask me for a pair of shoes. So what will you do to help us out? What will you do to fix the Medicaid laws for families who are struggling, for caregivers, and who are primarily women? And what will you do to help stop this crisis that's Alzheimer's?
Well, first of all, thank you for sharing your story. It's an exceptionally cruel disease, and it creates so much pressure and pain on everybody, especially involved in caring for a loved one who is suffering from that. And so I admire your turning that pain into activism and raising the visibility of this issue. Let me mention two or three things that would make a difference. First of all, just basic research on Alzheimer's. I believe in this idea that the first survivor of Alzheimer's is living among us today. And we can see to it that that's a reality. But that means stepping up our investments, CDC, NIH, and other areas of basic research where federal funding can make a huge difference, where the private sector just isn't ready to see a profit just yet. And we shouldn't have to wait. By the way, this gets better when we put science at the heart of our decision making and ensure that we actually believe in science in our policy. Secondly, the issue you described shows just how, there's no better way to put it, messed up our healthcare system is. It is telling you contradictory things. I remember a discussion with the social worker when we learned that my father might need long-term care, and just the look on my mother's eyes as the social worker explained that the best game plan was probably to exhaust yourself financially until you qualify for Medicaid. And this is what we're telling people. When you hit a medical situation like this, that the best option for you is to be to have everything that you saved drained into paying for this so that you qualify for public assistance. It is so upside down. And it's the reason why we need long-term care insurance. Stay tuned for our plan on long-term care, because we need to make sure people are in that situation. As well as having universal coverage that drives down the cost of different kinds of therapy and care to begin with. So that the cost side is also being addressed. The last thing I want to mention is the importance of caregiving as work. I think, frankly, precisely because caregiving has been considered women's work, so-called, helps to explain why society has not valued it as much. And so one dimension that I think is very important of our solution to Social Security is to ensure that there can be credit given for caregiving work in home, even if it's not in the formal economy or compensated, and have that count toward retirement benefits. All right, they're telling me it's the last one. Let's, can't quite see you on this side. Okay, we got a bit of a lot of popular support for this question. So.
Thank you very much. I'm very concerned about the Trump administration's war on journalism. Mm-hmm. Sorry. I sincerely apologize. I'm concerned about the Trump administration's war on journalism. As president, will you pardon Julian Assange? Will you commute his sentence? He is dying in prison, and he badly needs support in our government. He is a prosecuted Nobel Prize-nominated journalist. What will you do to help him?
Yeah, I'm not going to make any commitment as a candidate to issue a pardon to any individual. One more. Go ahead.
My name is Brittany, and I was just wondering that if under your presidency that those within the military, if they're found guilty of domestic violence, if they would actually be given anything other than honorable discharges from personal experience, would you see to it?
So I'm not sure I understand all of the legal dimensions of what you're describing, but I think what you're pointing to is the fact that justice in cases of domestic violence and, by the way, sexual assault is not being served by the existing military justice system. Would that be fair to say? And there's actually a parallel system which has denied justice to many survivors who have been caught between a military system which has allowed there to be a basic sort of, it's hard to describe, but basically a side channel that keeps things from being handled either by the Uniform Code of Military Justice or by civil law altogether. And this should not stand. It is so important that military families, people in a workplace that involves members of the military, and of course those in uniform themselves, know that domestic violence, sexual harassment, and sexual violence is not tolerated by anyone in uniform, just as it is not tolerated out of uniform. And yes, that affects the way that you could be discharged, as well as making sure that there are criminal remedies for anybody who commits a crime of domestic or sexual violence.
My ex-husband was guilty of two domestic violence cases separately, but was honorably discharged, and it was seen only within the military side because it was done on military base.
Wow, okay. I don't understand how that happened, but I would appreciate a chance to learn more about your case. And I also just want to recognize that standing up in a room full of people and drawing attention to this is an act of courage, and I hope you feel, even if your military didn't support you, that everybody here supports you. And I'd like to find you afterwards, if that's okay. Thank you. What a powerful set of reminders of the stakes that we face right now. We believe ourselves to be the most powerful, wealthy country in the world. We ought to be the best country in the world. And while we've got a lot to be proud of, we have heard stories tonight, both in what was prepared and in the experiences that you're sharing, that remind us of how much work we've got to do. Let's put ourselves in a position that one day we could watch a recording of this meeting and hear about the problems that were described here and say, God, I can't believe that. It used to be something that people worried about. And I'm so glad that we got together and acted to do something about it. I'm counting on you to be part of that. I will stand with you in being part of that. And I'm honored to have been able to spend this time with you this evening to talk about the road ahead. Thank you, and let's fix these issues tomorrow.